and take a look at the map.
That's a good idea. Now where is Switzerland?
It's here. I think we're quite close to Stumbledorf.
I can see the village quite clearly. The village square is quite large. There's snow on the mountains too. I bet it's cold there.
Sounds as though there might be strange creatures living there.
I hadn't thought of that. Come on.
Let's see.
If we can get closer.
However careful the villagers are, there always seems to be something for them to stumble on.
Morning, Klaus! Who lived out there?
The village is nestled at the foot of a mountain, and it really should be a happy place to live. After all, there's everything the village needs.
The butcher, the baker, the clockmaker, the plumber, the builder, the worker named Gilda.
The gardener,
the mayor,
the oompa band player,
the doctor,
the teacher,
the mythical creature.
Ah, yes. Stumbledorf is one feature the villagers aren't keen on at all. According to village folklore, this is a fierce, cruel, ruthless man-eating dragon.
No one here has actually seen the dragon, but it's deduced from ominous rumbles, trembling tremors, and an occasional puff of smoke from the direction of the mountain that it is real.
So in an attempt to keep it at bay, on every month what they call Dragon Day, they leave a big basket of goodies on the side of a mountain, and as this basket always disappears, the villagers assume that they are right.
Each month, as Dragon Day draws near, the villagers steel themselves to deliver the culinary bribe, their nerves becoming increasingly taut and their imagination ever more overactive.
I've made him one of my special pies. It's a little overdone, but I imagine he likes it burnt.
If he eats that, then we might be rid of him quicker than we think.
Dragon Day!
cunning plan does seem to work, and so far touch wood.
No one from the village has even been slightly eaten.
But you never know when you fancy a change of diet.
Of course, financially, this isn't an altogether satisfactory arrangement, as it stretches the household budget of the poor villagers.
One for you, one for me, and four for the dragon.
And so for a long time, they have yearned for someone to come and rescue them, as they themselves are not dragon slaying material.
Yeah.
One small ray of hope for Stumbledorf, the prophecy. Even long, long ago by three old crones that have magical powers.
The prophecy is so potent, it conjures up a vivid picture for the villagers each time they hear it.
Mumble, mumble, mutter, mumble. I am mute and we're who come.
courageous enough to fight the dragon, but they preferred her idea of a heroic man, especially the girls.
So Tommy Rumble now finds himself in an unusual position. He has never been particularly popular before, but suddenly, for most of Stumbledorf, he's the coolest guy in town.
Now let's stretch it out to the right. Oh, that's lovely. Now, slowly, carefully, touch your toes. And shake it out. Good job, everyone. See you next week.
In desperation, Tommy even tries working with a personal trainer.
Come on, Tommy, you can do it. Lean to the left, lean to the right. That's why I can not.
Thank you. He's as cool as a cucumber.
He's a whole enchilada.
The big cheese. The
long banana.
Hey, don't make me sound too evil.
The girls buzz around Charlie like bees around the honey pot. They all think he's such a good head.
You're doing the food thing again?
The boys are stalked by the green-eyed monster. But it isn't the dragon.
I think it looks a real big.
The girls don't even talk to us anymore.
Is that a bad thing?
Yeah, if they don't talk to us, how can we do them?
Hi, Glinda. Yoo-hoo.
Hey, I just had an idea. I'm officially a genius.
What is it?
It's to do with goats.
Goats?
Sure. Here, goats. And the fact that all we're going to do is a few more weeks of training. The reason to stand to meet up against the dragon is to help him. He'll have to up the mountain, let alone fighting a massive dragon.
So the goats are going to help him up the mountain?
No, Tommy is going to help Tommy. Come with me and I'll explain.
Meanwhile, unaware of the effect he's having on some of the boys, Tommy continues to impress his female friends with his machismo, courage, and rock-star good looks.
He really gives the dragon what for, leaving him in no doubt that Tommy Romola is a force to be reckoned with, from a safe distance, of course.
Right away.
Help! Help!
Help!
Help!
Help!
special meeting to discuss what to do.
Science! I expect you're wondering, why did they call this meeting?
No!
What are we going to do about the dragon?
Let Tommy know. He can save us. Tommy.
Wait a minute. I'm not sure I'm quite ready.
Tommy.
That's right. Tommy can save us.
Don't worry, Tommy. We'll help you.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, we've made up a list of helpful tips for you.
Tommy.
And so Tommy is sent off with the village's advice echoing in his ears.
If the wind blows from the east, lean to the west.
If he swoops from the sky, he'll jump under a rock.
If he crawls on the ground, leap up a tree.
Goodbye, my boy.
If he leaps from the west, swoop to the east. If he looks like a duck, go on a tree.
Good luck, Tommy!
Yeah, good luck, Tommy. I'm good riddance.
Oh my poor goats, how strange that the tin made the sound. And why did the dragon suddenly decide to eat them while it left them alone all this time? Yeah. Ooh, there's a nasty claw.
What's that smell? It smells like tomato sauce.
That's not blood, and that is no dragon claw. It's a trick. I must try to stop Tommy before he confronts the dragon.
Meanwhile, on the mountain, Tommy is so busy trying to remember the villagers' advice.
If he leaps from the west, swoop to the east.
If he flies through my west.
Then he quite forgets that this is Stumbledorf's mountain and
who left that?
He trips and falls, knocking himself unconscious. Oh, poor Tommy. What's going to happen to him?
Hello. Who goes there?
Oh, that's better. My voice in that cave of reverberation storm sounds quite fierce. Forsooth! I nearly gave myself a fright.
Yes, dude. Whatever is this?
He has the look of one from the village, though his garments look different. Those the villagers, your wolves.
Ha! Go away! Thou art a poet, and thou knowest it, or perhaps not. Come, go away, and do not linger longer. This lad looks to be in need of aid. He thinks I must lose my cave as a native strong poet.
No! Please don't eat him! Take me instead!
Eat him? Why would I want to consume this boy? I'm afraid, my lady, that I must catch his emotion that I'm some sort of monster. I have long kept my distance for human fight to be distasteful. In truth, my roar is much worse than my bite. Just because I'm bleeding scary doesn't mean I pay not. If you cut me, I will bleed.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Dragon. I just thought.
No, the sorrow is mine. Sometimes I get bit over the mat.
You fit in well and stumbled off then.
May I introduce myself? Gawain the Brilliant, at your service.
Gilda the Goatherd. How nice to meet you.
At one time, my lady Gilda, I did try to make friends with people. But as soon as they saw the sharpness of my teeth and the smoke from my nostrils, they ran out in an almighty terror or hurried off to gather weapons. I am but a peaceful fellow, so now I live in a lonely cave deep in the mountain.
You're all on your own?
Sadly, that is so. I sense the villagers don't want a friendship, because they leave me cold at the foot of the mountain, so that I don't need to enter the village, and they therefore want me to give up my ugliness.
Oh, Gawain, it's nothing to do with how you look. They're just scared. There have been so many stories, and what for me to think? We have heard some awful rumbling and felt terrible trouble coming from your mountain.
Ah, perchance that is the effect of my dancing and singing. It is always cheered me to sing the ancient dragon songs and perform the ancient dragon dance. Verily, this I fear must be the source of terrible temper around the occasion speak. Methinks I could not stop this activity, for I don't wish to fight anyone. So, Gawain, you must be so lonely. My heart is oft heavy. A dragon's life is not always a pleasant one. It's difficult to be so misunderstood.
Hey!
Gawain was right. The rumble of thunder grows louder and louder by the second. Gilda and Tommy can hardly move, trapped by the mighty wind.
Poor Tommy, what are we going to do? I can hardly see where I'm going.
We've got to try to keep moving, Gilda. Let's try this way.
Tommy, I'm scared. What if we don't make it back to the village?
Don't worry, Gilda. I'll make sure they come right. The storm may be scary, but it's nothing compared to when Tom takes us.
As the villagers arrive on the mountain, they too are caught up in the wild dance of swirling snowflakes. As the howling wind gets more and more fierce, it scoops up and makes it increasingly difficult to put one foot in front of another.
I tell you,
do help!
Then the villagers hear something that chills them to the bone even more. Although I suppose it could be the weather.
Stop!
because he's got so many friends. New dance to learn and the art of killing to conquer.
Actually, now might be a good time to mention that the prophecy was simply the result of one of the crows getting a rhyming dictionary for Christmas and having a go at poetry writing.
If you knew that, why didn't you tell us?
What, and spoil all your fun?
What about us, dragging us from our beds?
Well, I'm sure you'd like to be here for a big finish anyway.
I suppose so. I'd rather have been wearing something more glamorous though.
So now it's time for us to say goodbye to Stumbledorf and leave the villages and the wind to get to know each other and to sing the final song with a good moral theme.
Before you go, I'd like to know one thing.
What?